The studios didn't want to make Million Dollar Baby. Before that, they didn't want to make several of his other films. And he has to fight every single time.
It doesn't really matter who you are, getting a movie made is a difficult proposition. You would think, with his track record, coming up with a little gem like this, you'd say, yeah, just tell us what you want.
It's only total belief and conviction in what you're doing that you will ever get anything done. You can only prove you're right by doing it. This is a movie nobody wanted to make. Period.
When you discover what you want to do, just go for it.
This is a force to be reckoned with.
It was gonna get made. It's a short story by FX Tool, 70 pages, called Million Dollar Baby. I was taken with this story, so I get the rights and the material. It cost me a substantial amount of money for a little story, but I was glad to pay it. I got a call from Paul Haggis. He said, Al, I know how to do the screenplay. I will spec the script for you if you guarantee I can direct it. Paul Haggis is a great writer. I was excited to have him write it under any circumstance, but I was doing everything myself and funding it. So I thought, great idea. I said, Paul, we have a deal with one caveat. I will not do this as a low-budget, small movie with you directing it. I could sense it needed something to elevate the movie. With that condition, he writes a brilliant screenplay.
When I read the script for Million Dollar Baby, the writing was outstanding.
Tom Rosenberg was somebody that Howard gotten involved with as far as financing the development of the script.
Tom said, I'll finance the movie. Paul can direct it. We'll finance for $6-7 million. Oh, I can't do that. I need major elements to get this out of a small girl boxing movie. I was in Sun Valley 2 weeks later, and there's my friend Clint Eastwood.
I knew Al Reddy. He and I have come across each other for many years, and we became friends. And but we never worked together.
So I give Clint the script, and he reads it. He sees me the next morning. He said, "This is great, but it's a downer. God, is it a downer?" I said, "Clint, so you only do movies where you laugh or cry. Don't be in between." So he gives it to his wife that night, and she cries all night. Well, the next morning, he says, I'm in. So we're doing a Clint Eastwood movie.
That took it to a different place. Well, there was a budget that was significantly smaller before Clint than it was after Clint. So Al said, I need you to talk to Paul. So I did.
The cell phone rang. I picked it up and I said, Paul, this is Clint Eastwood. I went, yeah, right. is what it really was. But it sounded like an imitation of Clint Eastwood, because you never think Clint Eastwood was gonna sound like Clint Eastwood. It really was him. And I said, why don't we get together and you can give me your thoughts and notes and I can make any adjustments.
I started working on it and I started rewriting things, and I found out the more I screwed with it, the worse it was getting. I said, I'm doing what Siegel used to call killing it with improvements. So I called him back up and I said, I've changed my mind. I don't want to do anything to it. I'm going to leave it just the way you had it.
He goes, script's good. That was it, the script's good. He's just that kind of guy. He just has no pretense, puts the work first and everything else second. He does whatever it takes to get the work done.
He will not go to work until the script is to his satisfaction. And then he's only going to shoot that. Clint does not ad-lib. Once he reads it and says, this is it, it's done, that's the one he shoots.
Now, the main thing to do any project is you have to commit yourself. You have to not be afraid to just step forward and commit to it. You have to like it. And if you don't like it, you shouldn't be doing it.
I don't train girls.
Maybe you should. People see me fat, say I'm pretty tough.
Girly. Tough ain't enough.
If anyone else had directed Million Dollar Baby, I don't think it would have gotten much notice at all. Because look, it's a movie, it's a boxing movie. It's a girl boxing movie. It's a girl boxing movie about a woman who wants to kill herself in the end. I mean, who would see that film?
Nobody was clamoring to make this movie.
we talked with Warner Brothers because of Clint's relationship with Warner Brothers. But Warner Brothers' reaction was very negative about the project.
Warner Brothers said, why do you want to make this? I want to see this movie. But a girl boxer who dies with two old guys? Hey, if someone told me that idea, I wouldn't see it either.
Their problems with the script was that Maggie was a woman, and they thought that it was relentlessly downbeat and humorless.
They approached it like it was a girl boxing movie, and I didn't approach it that way. I approached it like it was a father-daughter love story. But you can't tell that to some people, because they read it, they just look at the obvious, and that's their prerogative. And maybe they're right.
Studios have their own needs. We all understand that. You'll always last longer on a job by saying no. Always. Because most of the time it doesn't work out. I understand. Clint understood. We all understood it. But understanding it doesn't mean you walk away from it.
In anything in life, you can't worry about making a mistake. Sometimes you'll get days where you think everything's working against you, but and there's other days that it falls into place.
When I do think it with its college kids, I say, you know, there's 150 students here. That means there's at least 150 projects out there. I can get each one of you in a room and tell you, well, you shouldn't do yours. Too much money, it's been done before, and no one's more. I'll give you all the reasons why you shouldn't do it. And if any one of you drop the project because of what I said, you should not be in this business.
Basically, you have to trust your own feelings, your own instincts, and your own taste in judging material. If you try to start pre-thinking what other people are thinking, you're going to get yourself in a real confused state.
And there was never any doubt in Clint's mind or mine that this movie was going to get made.
I offered Warner Brothers a deal structure that they basically couldn't really turn down, and they accepted.
It wouldn't have happened without Tom Rosenberg, and he's one of the smartest guys in the town.
In fact, when we talked it through about the casting and so forth, Al said, well, you're the only one crazy enough to make this movie anyway, so whatever you want to do. Yeah.
And he gives it to his friend Hilary Swank in New York.
I remember reading it, and from page one to the end, I thought it was perfect. There was nothing about it that I thought should be changed.
At a certain point, I gave Morgan the script. He said, I'll play either part. I'll play the black guy or the white guy. What do you want? And he could have done both.
Clint called me one evening and said, which part were you thinking of playing? And I said, well, if we do it, I should do Scrap Iron. And he said, well, that's good, because I wanted to do Frankie.
Clint was not looking for an acting job, incidentally.
I had done quite a few pictures where I directed and acted. Not always the easiest thing in the world to do. I just liked the character and I liked the plot so well, I just wanted to be the guiding force on it.
So, well, what do you have? You end up Clint Eastwood, Hilary Swank, Morgan Freeman, and Clint directing? Give me a break.
So, what's the plan? I know you got one, so you might as well tell me what it is.
When you're working with Clint Eastwood, you come on the set, everything organized. It's the crew he's had around him for years. That's his crew. He loves them, they love him.
They know what he wants, and everything is really economical.
He comes to the set. Usually they start around 9 o'clock. Everyone's prepared. They're usually rolling by 9:15.
Clint and his crew know what they're doing. Clint's very specific in the way he works. I learned the most from him, watching him work.
He doesn't say action. He doesn't say cut. He doesn't say anything conventional. Roll sound, he'll say anytime, something like that, whenever you feel like it. Oh, and when the scene's over, he'll say, that ought to do.
Well, what about you, Scrap? What did your manager do? You were a hell of a fighter, a lot better than Willie. He gets you a title fight, or did he just bust you out banging your head against other people's fists until you lost your eye?
I had my shot. I went out swinging, and no man can say I didn't.
Yeah, well, I remember. And excuse me if I didn't want my fighter spending the second half of his life cleaning up other people's spit.
Yeah, right. Right, you're the smart one. You're the one learning Greek.
It's Gaelic.
Well, you just protected yourself out of a championship fight. How do you say that in Gaelic?
Actors like me, and there are a lot of us who don't like to be directed. Director makes the movie. You hire actors. Clint believes that very strongly, being an actor himself.
I've been there as an actor, and I know what actors like and dislike. I know what makes them impatient, and I know what makes them nervous and relaxed. I just direct like I like directors to direct me when I was out there.
I think one of the reasons that actors love working with Clint is the same reason that writers love working with Clint, is that he trusts you. He just trusts you, you know, and you go, damn, he trusts you much more than you trust yourself. So we just love him for it.
In this world, we need people who believe in us. Everybody does. And Clint believed in me, just like Frankie believed in Maggie. And he gave me that gift. It was an extraordinary feeling to have that support and that confidence behind you.
My brother's in prison. My sister cheats on welfare by pretending one of her babies is still alive. My daddy's dead, and my mama weighs 312 pounds. If I was thinking straight, I'd go back home, find a used trailer, buy a deep fryer and some Oreos. The problem is, this is the only thing I ever felt good doing. If I'm too old for this, then I got nothing. That enough truth to suit you?
And his ability to see and watch while he's acting with me is nothing short of astonishing.
What do I do about the bear?
All right, you know that step into the outside and hook into the river?
I've been doing it. She's made of steel.
I know, but I don't want you to go to the liver this time. I want you to hit it right up under her skinny ass, understand? Right in the sciatic nerve. Just keep digging it in there, digging it in, and just keep sticking her. You hear that?
What about the ref?
Just keep yourself between the ref and the bear, and everything will just be fine.
Yeah, I got to be on the set of Million Dollar Baby quite a bit.
I don't have any complex about having the writer around, which some people maybe they do. I figure if the guy's bright enough to write it, he's certainly bright enough to be there. And sometimes I'll confer with him, or I'll show it, tell him what I'm doing along the way.
He doesn't do rehearsals.
We didn't do much rehearsing, really. We just rehearse the scene, we start the scenes and run through them, and then start shooting.
He did a couple of times in this movie and stuff that the actor thinks he was just blocking it out.
Often what'll happen is, well, he'll say, why don't you walk over and pick up that coffee? He'll just go like this to his operator. And they'll turn over, and sound knows to turn over, and no one announces that we're rolling. I actually turn around and go, okay, let's do it. You know, he goes, no, I shot already. And it was just the rehearsal, you walk through, it's done, it's good. And you go, what do you mean? I go, no, it was good. And they'll ask, but I'd really like another one. I go, Clint would say, why?
It's where you're going. That's it. I go, well, you're never going to do better than that. Let's move it.
I personally like to get them rolling on it because I like to see it new. You know, I don't want to see it too many times so I can feel the freshness of it. If there's something wrong, then you can spot it right away.
He's been doing it for so long that he's come to a place where he just trusts his instincts.
He's just right. When he's right, he's right. He doesn't have to think about it.
He knows what he wants, and when he's got it, and generally, that's going to be the first take.
The worst thing you can ever do to an actor, the worst thing you can do, is do 4-5 takes. The energy can't go up, it goes down. They start making conscious choices. If you can get a really talented actor to get it once, do it.
You have to step up, because you have to be ready on that first take. That might be the only take you get.
It's do your homework, figure out what it is you want to bring to the set, and bring it. And everyone brings their A game.
We were preparing the picture. I knew I'd have to strengthen her up. She was in New York at the time. A friend of mine back there, Grant Roberts, he happened to be in New York, so I said, go over and talk to Hillary. We need to put some muscle on her.
Hillary trained for about 4 or 5 months. This was 6 days a week in the gym. This was a tough gym. These were professional fighters for the most part in this gym.
Well, I was a vegetarian at the time, which made putting on muscle very intense. I trained for 3 months, 6 days a week, 4.5 to 5 hours a day. I box 2.5 hours every day and then weights on the other side. To put on that muscle, I had to eat about 210 grams of protein every day. And in order to do that as a vegetarian, I had to eat 60 egg whites every day, which is impossible. So I would just drink them. And I had to eat every hour and a half. So I'd wake up in the night and drink protein shakes and drink egg whites and protein shakes and egg whites and protein shakes and egg whites. It was
And then she came out here. I put her with Don Framlington, who's a boxing coach out here. So we just kind of kept her going all the time. So she was in magnificent condition when she started the picture. As she was ready to roll, you know. I was pleased with it.
She became a competent fighter. She had a great left hook. If she hits you with a left hook, you go to the hospital. Hillary became Maggie. That's all.
Honestly, I just kept saying to myself, don't ruin it. I just kept saying, don't ruin it. You know, I was scared I was gonna mess it up. I wouldn't be able to live with that.
Well, I could use a good second. Can't find one, I thought I'd ask you.
Now, why the hell would I wanna do that?
Well, because you're a half-blind old fool who never got there himself. I thought you might like to feel what it's like to be in a ring title match. Excuse me for feeling sorry for you.
Nah, you pick up somebody there in Vegas. Somebody with young hands.
Well, you're not gonna cry now, are you? I've already got one girl.
The relationship between Eddie and Frankie is survival. I think Scrap Iron's surviving through the good graces of Frankie.
Morgan is a great actor. He's a gentleman like Clint. He's a great presence on the set. They're a great team.
You got big holes in your socks.
Oh, they're not that big.
Didn't I give you money for some new ones?
These are my sleeping socks. My feet like a little air at night.
How come you're wearing them in the daytime, then?
Because my daytime socks got too many holes in them.
Frankie blames himself for Scrap Iron's condition in life. But Scrap Iron can't convince Frankie that it wasn't Frankie's fault. Frankie walks around with that guilt on his shoulders.
Frankie was a guy who was sort of an emotionally damaged person. He's a guy who's sort of cynic about his own religion.
Father, that was a great sermon. Made me weep.
What's confusing you this week?
Oh, it's the same old one God, three God thing.
Frankie, most people figure out by kindergarten it's about faith.
Is it sort of like snap, crackle, and pop all rolled up in one big box?
You're standing outside my church comparing God to Rice Krispies?
As the Frankie Dunn character all the way through this piece, he's a hardened, insulated human being.
Working the bag, boss.
Not your boss. You have bags working you.
Look, Clint can bring that no one else can, or very few people can. He's got that core, the strength. So he brings that hard quality, and he fights it against everything he knows in life. He's got to take this girl on.
Stop, stop, stop. God damn it, stop. The hell are you doing? Okay. If I'm gonna take you on...
You won't never regret it.
Look, just listen to me. If I take you on...
I promise I'll work so hard.
God, this is a mistake already.
The female boxing was the action part of the film. It became more of a story about the family relationship.
Got any family, boss?
What?
You're spending all this time with me, I didn't know if you had any.
No. Well, I've got a daughter, Katie.
That's family.
We're not exactly close.
The character is trying to find the relationship with a surrogate daughter that he'd never had with his real daughter.
It's quite definitely a story about family. Two people who are symbiotic in their interdependence.
I got nobody but you, Frankie.
Well, you've got me.
Actually, it makes me emotional talking about it because it's exactly how our relationship evolved as director, actor, and then how it built into a friendship.
And what happens? She breaks through his armor. She cracks him wide open. She's a daughter he can't find.
And then, of course, he loses her, so it becomes a terrible tragedy.
He wanted the death scene for the last day. When I tell you, everybody was crying. We had the makeup girl with a box of Kleenex.
Makushla means my darling, my blood.
We all believed it. We all were watching a guy, a girl, a person he loved dying in front of him. And it was so overwhelming. It was so emotionally wrenching.
I loved him, Unforgiven, but boy, Million Dollar Baby, he really put me away.
Put together the first cut, he said, why do you and I run it for the heads of Warner Brothers, the two guys? I said, okay. The other, the four of us go in the theater. I got the two executives on my left. The one on my left was the one who told me, why do I want to make this ugly movie? I'm not kidding you. Three quarters of the way through this movie, the executive has his glasses off and he's crying. I think they sensed that they had something special.
I thought the movie was outstanding. It was just one of Clint's best works, both as a filmmaker and as an actor.
I was stunned when we met the first time. He has that quality in his movies that you feel the guts of what's going on.
When I saw the film, I realized how he guided me in certain ways, yet I didn't know it when it was happening.
Now the relationship with Clint went the other way. How do you sell this movie about a girl boxer, especially a girl boxer who dies? The whole success or fate of that movie, it all hinged on that the critics were gonna pick up on.
Clint wanted to qualify for the awards, and that meant that it had to be out by a certain date that year. And Clint went to Warner Brothers and made it happen.
It was interesting because Dan Feldman, who is in charge of releasing films and booking films, he liked the film a lot, and he said, what do you think? What do you want to do? I said, well, why don't we just release it? And he said, I mean, just what do you mean? Just put it out there and see what people think of it.
The way Warner's distributed the film was really smart. They saw it as a long hold. They always saw the movie as just staying in it, staying there and staying there.
It all hinged on a certain courage that Warner Brothers went along with, to a large degree on Clint Eastwood's insistence that we give it that shot.
You never know about audiences. You can't start anticipating what they're thinking because you may be wrong. You can't really think about that. It has to be what it is. It just kind of caught on. A lot of reviewers liked it. A lot of good reception. It took on a life of its own.
Gus got sugar.
If it was going to be the last movie I ever made in my life, I'd say that's the movie I want to go on. Because there is nothing more you will ever find in Hollywood. Nothing. No more money, no more sense of accomplishment, no more prevailing even in that you believed in something so strongly. And you were right. You were right. And the only way you proved it is you did it.
As an actor, to get the opportunity to work with a legend like him, if I had to be done tomorrow and I could never do it again, having the experience with him would make it okay.
Good man to have in the corner.
Yes, he is.
It could have easily been a terrible flop. All movies can easily be a terrible flop. And good movies don't always do well, and bad movies sometimes do great. So there's no rule. There's no rule you can follow. Everybody thinks there's a rule, and everybody thinks that they've got the answer, but nobody has the answer.
At the end of the day, the movie was up there, and the movie worked. It was alive.